Good afternoon. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio questions is Justice and Veterans. And can I remind members that questions 4 and 8 are grouped together and that I'll take any supplementaries on these questions after both have been answered. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. Question number 1, Emma Harper.
To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting Police Scotland to implement and enforce legislation on the control of dogs.
Minister Ash Regan.
I'm aware that Emma Harper's Protection of Livestock Scotland Act came into force at the weekend, and I pay tribute to the member and all those involved in making that important legislation a reality. The Scottish Government worked with Police Scotland and others to help arrange for the commencement of that legislation, and more generally, Police Scotland are valued members of the Scottish Government-led Dog Control and Dangerous Dogs Working Group. Work carried out by this group includes a review of the Control of Dogs Joint Protocol Agreement between Police Scotland and local authorities, as well as establishing a national dog control database, which will assist enforcement of dog control measures.
Emma Harper.
I thank the Minister for that response. The Minister will be aware that my Dogs Protection of Livestock Amendment, as she has agreed, came into force last Thursday. The Act strengthens the penalties available for those who allow out-of-control dogs to worry or attack livestock, and it extends the powers of police and the Crown Office to investigate these offences. Can the Minister outline whether any guidance has been produced for police and vets on the investigation and enforcement of the offence?
Minister.
Yes, I'm pleased to confirm that officials have worked closely with stakeholders to assist with the development of guidance that's been prepared for private vets on what should happen if a live dog is seized by the police and presented to a private vet for examination. I should stress that we think this is unlikely to be a frequent occurrence. The guidance has been discussed in detail with Police Scotland, with veterinary organisations, including the Royal College of Veterinary Surgeons and the British Veterinary Association, and with the Scottish SPCA. It's close to agreement, and it will be published on the Scottish Government website by the end of November.
Question number 2, Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government, in light of reported Crown Office findings that there has been a 9% increase in reported charges with a domestic abuse identifier during the COVID-19 pandemic, what action it is taking to support victims of domestic violence?
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
We all recognise that during the coronavirus pandemic, for some people, their home has not been a place of safety, and sadly that, as a member mentioned, that has been reflected in a 9% increase in the number of domestic abuse charges reported to the Crown Office and Fiscal Service in the last year. And that's why in the first 100 days of this government, we directed £5 million of new funding to domestic abuse services and rape crisis centres to help cut waiting lists for specialist support services. And that was in addition to the £5.75 million allocated last year to support frontline organisations' COVID response and recovery so they could respond to an increase in demand from victims of abuse.
Colin Beattie.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. Can I ask what steps the Scottish Government is taking to ensure more people are aware of the support that you outlined in your answer, and what support will be given to local organisations to help deliver their services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, I'm sure the member and other members will be aware of the many advertisements on TV and in the media around this issue, but we, for our part, remain committed to raising awareness of domestic abuse, and we support Scotland's Domestic Abuse and Forced Marriage Helpline, which is available 24/7 to support anybody with experience of domestic abuse. And later this month, we will launch a campaign to reach those most at risk and ensure survivors are aware of the support that continues to be available. We continue to invest significant levels of funding in specialist frontline services. Our new Delivering Equally Safe Fund recently confirmed allocations to 121 projects from 112 organisations working to provide key services and to prevent gender-based violence.
Supplementary, Jamie Green.
Thank you. 4 in 5 victims of domestic abuse are women. That truly is a shocking statistic, we all agree. But it remains true that over 10,000 incidents involved male victims of abuse. Can I ask if any of the funds that was mentioned in the previous answer by the Cabinet Secretary will be allocated towards charities such as Abused Men in Scotland and other organisations who do support male victims of abuse, so they get their fair and proportionate share of government support as well?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member raises an important point, and we are absolutely clear there is no excuse for domestic abuse, regardless of the gender of the victim or of the perpetrator. The victims in over 80% of cases are female, but we recognise that men can be victims of domestic abuse too, perpetrated either by women or in same-sex relationships. And we are funding a range of services to support male victims, and that includes providing nearly £190,000 over 2017-23 to run the Respect Helpline, which signposts male survivors of domestic abuse to support services. And over the same period, we're providing £5.6 million to assist, who as part of their work provide advocacy support to male survivors of domestic abuse in the west of Scotland in the Lothians. And we also fund the Scottish Domestic Abuse and Forced Marriage Helpline, as I mentioned, to support both male and female victims and survivors.
And supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Does the domestic abuse identifier include any evidence of increasing abuse to pets, usually dogs, which are used by perpetrators to coerce and control their partners?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can't say that it does, and if it does, I haven't seen it, so I'm happy to go and look into that, and if you have more information, I can provide to the member to write to the member with that information.
Question number three, Michelle Thompson, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it will ensure the consumer voice is adequately heard in the Legal Services Regulation Reform Consultation.
Minister.
A public consultation based on Esther Robertson's recommendations from her independent review of Legal Services Regulation was published on the 1st of October, and it will run until the 24th of December 2021. And we've published a summary consultation as well, and that's designed to allow participants without detailed knowledge of the current framework of regulation to share their views and their priorities on legal services regulation reform. In parallel, we are undertaking a series of consultation focus groups to increase the opportunity for the public to respond to the consultation, either in part or in whole. Details of the consultation have been shared on the Scottish Government's Twitter page, and we continue to engage with stakeholder networks such as Citizens Advice Scotland, Scottish Women's Aid and the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission to amplify and to promote the consultation to ensure that we reach as wide an audience as possible. And the consultation is available on the Scottish Government website if anyone is interested and wants to respond to it.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Minister for her response and declare I am an interested party as I have a current complaint. Section A on potential regulatory models requires strong responses from consumers, and particularly from those such as myself who have direct and recent experience of the current system. At present, I believe it is heavily biased against the consumer's interest. Firstly, will the Minister meet with me to hear about my experience? And secondly, will the Government issue an urgent call to consumer voice to ensure consumer voices are heard, and not just the lawyers and their representative bodies?
Minister.
I agree. I think a strong response from consumers, those with lived experience, is very important as ministers consider this reform, and I'm clear that the future framework should place consumer interests at its heart. I offer assurance to the member that the Scottish Government is actively encouraging consumers to participate in the consultation. We engaged early with the SLCC consumer panel to seek their advice on doing this. And I would call on all consumers with an interest to participate in the consultation that I mentioned in my previous answer. And I'd be very happy to meet with the member to discuss this matter in more detail.
Question number four, Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure the dignity, security and well-being of Scotland's veteran community.
Cabinet Secretary.
Last year, my predecessor presented to Parliament a response to the UK-wide veteran strategy, which set out the commitments that we've made to the veterans community right through to 2028 to improve service delivery and mainstream support. And progress against that is reported through our annual update to Parliament, which I'll deliver tomorrow. In addition, Scotland was first within the UK to establish an independent Veterans Commissioner whose recommendations have assisted and occasionally challenged our work over the last several years and ensured that our wider policies have been developed with views of the veterans sector firmly represented.
Evelyn Tweed.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. I welcome that we have doubled the funding for the Veterans Fund this year, and I would like to ask the Scottish Government to elaborate on how interested parties can apply for support from the Veterans Fund.
Cabinet Secretary.
The application period for next year's Scottish Veterans Fund is currently open and it closes on Friday the 12th of November. Interested parties are able to apply for the fund via Veterans Scotland's website. And this year we are particularly welcoming bids which promote collaboration and partnership from amongst and out with the veterans charitable sector, as well as projects with a focus on early service leavers. And I would just mention that we continue to have support, financial support in this from the company previously known as Aberdeen Asset Management. I'm not entirely sure how to pronounce their new name, but that's who they were then.
And question number 8, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps are being taken to assist veterans in readjusting to civilian life.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, our response to the Veterans Strategy sets out our ambition to make Scotland a destination of choice for service leavers and their families. And we've made several commitments on how we will support veterans' transition into civilian life. And that includes inputting to the MOD's holistic transition policy and working with the Defence Transition Services. The Scottish Veterans Commissioner has also published reports on employability, skills and learning and housing, both focused on transition from military to civilian life. And we accepted all of the recommendations in those reports and have outlined to the Commissioner how we intend to take these forward.
Jackie Dunbar.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. I have recently been contacted by a national charity, Veterans First, who have highlighted that some veterans struggle to engage with support services, specifically housing services, where there are no veterans or serving officers involved and engaging in their case. What engagement is the Scottish Government having with veterans charities to ensure that the support we are providing is accessible and fit for purpose for all our veterans?
Cabinet Secretary.
I should say that we fund Housing Options Scotland to provide housing advice and advocacy services to older and to disabled people, and that includes support for the Military Matters Project, aimed specifically at helping veterans. We also commissioned the Veterans Scotland Housing Group to develop a pathway to prevent homelessness for veterans, and they, of course, as Veterans Scotland, have regular and wide-ranging dialogue and engagement with veterans. And that initiative looks at transition from the armed forces and reasons why veterans become homeless many years, sometimes after leaving service. The report, with its recommendations, is due to be published later this year, and furthermore, we continue to fund Veterans Scotland to support their capacity to deliver leadership, communication and coordination across the veterans charitable sector.
Question number 5, Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what impact its revised rules on the use of fireworks have had on antisocial behaviour complaints related to Bonfire Night.
Minister.
Can I start by paying tribute to the police officers and the firefighters who've responded to incidents of antisocial behaviour around Bonfire Night this year, and also to condemn those individuals who chose this occasion to launch attacks on them. The contribution of our emergency services at this time, their planning, their preparation, alongside the work of local authorities as well and community safety partners, has helped promote safety and well-being in our communities. Now, initial data from Police Scotland suggests that complaints this year were down on previous years. Over the 4th and 5th of November, calls about fireworks were down by 20% on last year, while calls about fires were down nearly a third. And data from the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service reflects a broadly similar experience. This is encouraging. It's likely due to the preventative activity to which I alluded and to several other factors, including the new legislation, which deals with the sale as well as the use of fireworks. I have to say, however, that the level of antisocial behaviour and disruption to our communities remains unacceptable around the time of Bonfire Night, and I am committed to making further progress with the bill that we promised in our programme for government and which we hope to introduce to Parliament shortly.
Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to reiterate the tribute paid by the Minister to our emergency services personnel who were responding to complaints over the weekend. And I'm also really pleased that the Scottish Government has taken this action to restrict the sale and use of fireworks. Bonfire Night is normally great fun for families, but for some people, including veterans and people with autism or sensory issues, it can be frightening for them and for animals. So I would appreciate if the Minister could elaborate more on what the Scottish Government will do now to review these new restrictions and whether more needs to be done alongside the UK Government, who also have responsibility in this area.
Minister.
I share the Member's concerns about those vulnerable groups, and that was prominent in our publicity campaigns around Bonfire Night this year. We're following up with our partner organisations to review the impact of the new restrictions. And I think initial indications on that are positive. But however, we do understand that more is required, and we have a commitment, obviously, to introduce the bill to implement the Firework Review Group's remaining recommendations. And as I said, that will be coming forward shortly. As far as the UK Government are concerned, I have to say to the Member, I'm not that hopeful. I think when this issue was raised by Patricia Gibson MP, the Leader of the House of Commons responded to her by quoting a nursery rhyme and telling us all to stop being killjoys. So I don't think that demonstrates quite what we're looking for, Presiding Officer. We will use all the powers that are available to us in our bid to change Scotland's culture around fireworks.
Question number six, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on community justice.
Cabinet Secretary.
It's worth stating, of course, that sentencing decisions are, of course, a matter for the independent courts. However, evidence shows that community sentences are more effective than short custodial sentences, and action continues to be taken to encourage a shift towards more widespread use of community sentences and other interventions where they are appropriate. Our most recent criminal proceedings stats show that 22% of all convictions in 2019-20 resulted in a main penalty of community service. That's the highest proportion over the past 10 years, up from 14% in 2010-11 and from 19% in the previous year's statistics. Of course, there are challenges, not least the impact of the pandemic on capacity to deliver community services, and we welcome recent reports and scrutiny from Audit Scotland, the Scottish Sentencing Council and the Public Audit Committee. In addition to ongoing consultation and engagement with stakeholders, these will inform the development of a revised community justice strategy next year and consideration around how best to build on progress over recent years to build further capacity and confidence in effective community-based interventions.
Craig Hoy.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Research commissioned by the Scottish Sentencing Council found that 77% of the public believe a first-time offender caught with indecent images of a child should serve a prison sentence. But in reality, such offenders are most likely to receive a community payback order, a sentence supported by only 2% of the public, in a system undermined by a government which let criminals go scot-free by cancelling a quarter of a million hours of community sentences earlier this year. So will the Minister now commit to reversing the government's presumption against short prison sentences, meaning that those who commit crimes such as the possession of indecent images of children actually go to jail?
Cabinet Secretary.
First of all, just to say that I do not pass sentences. The government doesn't do that. The sentences are delivered by the courts in this country, the independent courts in this country. And I've just mentioned the fact that community sentencing sentences are more effective than the short sentences that he mentions. It's worth mentioning, as I've said to the committee this morning, that more people in the prison sector are spending more time in prison than they have done in recent years. But just on this subtext of this soft justice kind of approach, to be accused of soft justice when we have 40% more police officers than they do in England and Wales, that we pay them a pay rise, which they don't do in England and Wales, that we have the lowest recorded crime in living memory, that we have the lowest recorded number of homicides, every one of which was solved, is anything but soft justice in this country.
Question number seven, Willie Rennie.
To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to incorporate the recent HMICS findings in relation to Police Scotland into the ongoing response to the independent review into police complaints handling investigations and misconduct issues conducted by Dame Elish Angelini.
Cabinet Secretary.
Police Scotland's response to the HMICS report is a matter for the Chief Constable, with a clear role also for the SPA in overseeing the implementation of the recommendations. I am aware, however, that Police Scotland intends to consider these recommendations alongside the work already underway in relation to Dame Eilish's review. The governance and reporting framework established by the Scottish Government plays a vital role in overseeing and providing assurance to ministers and ultimately to Parliament on progress towards implementation of Dame Eilish's recommendations across all partners. The Scottish Government published its first thematic progress report on the 24th of June 2021, which showcased the progress made, and work is currently underway to develop the next thematic progress report, which is due for publication by the end of this year.
Willie Rennie.
I'm concerned that a year on from the Angelini report, there are few signs of improvement. There have been more reports of sexism, and we have a high proportion of ethnic minority officers leaving, way more than other groups. Our research has found that only 1% of top policing jobs are held by people from BAME backgrounds. And officers have little confidence in the leadership of Police Scotland to change. Does the Cabinet Secretary have more confidence?
Cabinet Secretary.
I do have confidence in the senior police officers within Police Scotland to effect change, and that's based on quite a number of conversations and meetings and reports I've had in relation to this area. Especially at the very senior level, Deputy Chief Constable level, I am absolutely convinced of the earnest intent of the senior officers. But Willie Rennie is right to say that's neither here nor there if it doesn't permeate its way right down through the service, and there are very serious initiatives underway to do that. In relation to the initiatives which I mentioned in Dame Eilish's report, a number of those recommendations have already been implemented. There are some which will require legislation which will take some more time. For example, barred an advisory list so we don't employ people in Police Scotland that have come from other police forces where they've conducted themselves inappropriately. And also the practice whereby a police officer can behave very badly and then retire their way out of an investigation, we have to legislate for that. So I would just reassure Willie Rennie that I do believe that the Police Scotland are very serious about this, and also that the recommendations made by Dame Eilish and in relation to the points made by the inspector's report are being taken forward very seriously.
Supplementary, Russell Finlay.
Thank you. In the interest of transparency, will the Cabinet Secretary reconsider our party's suggestion of an online action tracker so the public can see exactly what is happening in respect of each of Dame Eilish Angelini's 111 recommendations, or not happening as the case may be?
Cabinet Secretary.
In the interest of consensus, I will undertake to look at that suggestion. I'm certainly more than happy to give a full account of where we are in relation to all the recommendations, some of which, of course, have been taken forward by the SPA, some of which will be taken forward by Police Scotland, and some of which rest with the government. So I'm happy to give a full account for that, and it may be the member wants to publish that himself. But if it is possible to do what he has suggested, then I would undertake to look at that and come back to the member in due course.
And supplementary, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps are being taken to ensure that both policing by consent and a rights-based approach to policing continue to form the core of policing practice ethos.
Cabinet Secretary.
This is an absolutely fundamental question, and I think the traditions and approach to which the member refers continue to lie at the heart of policing practice and ethos in Scotland. And when trust goes, then consent can go afterwards as well. So we have to be very keen to make sure that we maintain that trust and consent. The SPA has a responsibility to hold the Chief Constable to account for policing in Scotland, and through its board and committee meetings, a series of checks and balances is implemented to ensure that major decisions about the policing of Scotland are made transparently and appropriately. And that helps to ensure that Scottish policing is based on public consent in a way that commands respect and builds public trust and confidence. In addition, Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary in Scotland has wide-ranging statutory powers in this and efficiency of both Police Scotland and the SPA.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And we switch to finance and the economy. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. Question number one, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it plans to allocate additional funding in its forthcoming budget to provide pay increase for frontline public sector workers.
And the Cabinet Secretary responding is Kate Forbes, who is joining us remotely. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Government is currently in the process of developing its budget for next year, and as agreed with the Finance and Public Administration Committee, I'll bring proposals to Parliament on the 9th of December. We have, of course, offered our progressive pay policy over recent years, balancing reward and affordability, protecting the most vulnerable and supporting our frontline staffs. I recognise the achievements of our public sector workforce, and accordingly, we will look to retain our fair approach to pay.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the reply. The true value of social care, despite the low pay that is endemic throughout the sector, these workers have been at the forefront of caring for and protecting our loved ones who have been most vulnerable to COVID-19. Will the Government show that they are serious about investing in social care by delivering an immediate uplift to £12 per hour?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member will know that supporting our frontline workers in the social care sector was a key part of the Cabinet Secretary for Health's announcement just a few weeks ago with financial support. But I quite agree with the member that we need to continue to recognise their efforts, including with the pay policy. And that's why this year's pay policy prioritise support for those who are earning the least, and also ensured that all workers in the social care sector are paid at least the living wage. We did all of that despite no consequential funding coming from the UK government, because of course there was a pay freeze south of the border.
Question number two, Richard Leonard.
Thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when it will produce consolidated accounts for the whole public sector in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we are committed to producing additional consolidated public sector accounts covering the devolved public bodies in Scotland. Obviously, and I hope the member recognises this, the pandemic has impacted timescales for the production and the audit of accounts across all sectors, and that affects the availability and the timeliness of information for further consolidation. But an outline plan is being developed with Audit Scotland for a staged approach to produce additional accounts for the 2020-21 financial year.
Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? But will she accept that this was promised to Parliament and the people back in 2016? It was then promised during 2018, then by March 2019, then in November 2019, it was promised in due course. By February this year, we were told it was no longer possible to set out a timetable at all. Will the Cabinet Secretary accept that this is about public transparency and trust? It's about good government, open government, good democracy, open democracy. Why can't the Cabinet Secretary set out a timetable? When will the Cabinet Secretary finally address this breach of promise to Parliament and to the people and publish these whole government accounts?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I just clarify that we already comply with all financial reporting and auditing requirements, and we're committed to developing the financial reporting to support the transparency that the member talks of. But it's recognised by the Auditor General and by Audit Scotland that this is a complex task and that work has been done to make progress to date. Now, the member asks for a timetable. So the first stage will be a draft account covering the Scottish administration and reflecting the wider composition of the Scottish budget as authorised by Parliament. The aim is for this to be audited and finalised by spring 2022. And that will be followed by further work in summer 2022 to develop the wider output, including local authorities. We want to minimise the burden on public bodies. The member will know the pressures that have been on all public bodies during the pandemic. And I think that most people understand that this is a complex issue requiring time and capacity from all members of the Scottish public sector.
Question number three, Gillian Martin, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it's supporting the economy of the North East in terms of a just transition for workers away from oil and gas.
And this question is being responded to by Richard Lochhead, Minister, who is joining us remotely. Minister.
The Scottish Government is committed to producing sectorial and regional just transition plans, and this year's programme for government includes a commitment to develop our first just transition plan for the energy sector alongside a refreshed energy strategy. And we will work with communities and with those who are most impacted across Scotland, including our very highly skilled oil and gas workforce, to co-design that plan. And we will also support our planning process by taking forward a 10-year, £500 million just transition fund for the North East and Moray.
Gillian Martin.
Thank the Minister for that answer. He'll know that many of the routes to certification and accreditation for oil and gas workers over the decades have been through private companies. In the past, employers have largely picked up the tab for this training, but many workers looking to transition into other low-emission energy sectors tell me that they're having to find the money themselves to retrain, and for many these sums are simply not affordable. So I'd like to ask the Minister what routes are being investigated using publicly funded institutions like North East Scotland College to deliver training using the expertise that they have, and how the government could support them to quickly develop courses which are accessible to people who cannot be available during the working day and need a flexibility of offer.
Minister.
I thank Gillian Martin for highlighting what's a crucial issue about the just transition, and we are working with North East Scotland organisations who in turn are working with local further and higher education institutions to make sure that the right skills are available for people who are moving out of fossil fuel sectors and into decarbonised industries. And of course, Gillian Martin will be aware that the Green Skills Minister, Lorna Slater, is also working up proposals for a skills guarantee. But we're also working with the Energy Skills Alliance, and that's a newly created and cross-energy collaboration group that's been established to develop an integrated skills strategy for a net zero energy sector. And one of their work streams is focusing on the development of an all-energy training and standards, which will look to assess transferability of skills to ensure the workforce skills that we do require are there and people can move easily across. So we're working with a number of publicly funded organisations and, of course, the further and higher education sector on this important issue.
And supplementary, Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As part of the fair and managed transition to renewable energy, does the Minister welcome the North Sea Transitions deals, joint government and oil and gas sector investment of up to £16 billion to reduce carbon emissions by 2030?
Minister.
Of course, the Scottish Government's taking action, and the UK Government is as well, which we welcome. The Scottish Government has also announced, as I mentioned in response to Gillian Martin, a £500 million transition fund for the North East and Moray over the next 10 years. And we have asked the UK Government to match that. I hope the Member will support our appeal to the UK Government to match that as well, because it is a very important issue to make sure there's good green jobs available for people in fossil fuels as we go through the transition in the coming decades.
Question number 4, not lodged. Question number 5, Martin Whitfield.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking to tackle the employment gap for disabled people in light of the reported findings from the annual population survey 2020 to 21, that the employment rate for disabled people was 47.4%, which was lower than that for non-disabled people.
Minister Richard Lochhead.
In a Fairer Scotland for Disabled People Employment Action Plan published back in 2018, we committed to half the employment gap between disabled people and the rest of the working population by 2038. And we are making early progress towards this. Support for disabled workers is a key element of our employability programmes, such as No One Left Behind and Young Persons Guarantee, and also Fair Start Scotland. And working with disabled people's organisations and others, we are undertaking a refresh of the action plan due to be published in spring 2022.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm grateful to the Minister for that response. Yet the scheme's third annual report revealed that the FSS did not reach as many people with disabilities and health conditions as you set out that it would. It's simply not good enough. So why are the Scottish Government failing to support so many disabled people into employment through the Fair Start Scotland as was intended?
Minister.
Fair Start Scotland is delivering for people with a variety of circumstances and backgrounds. and there was recently an evaluation report of that. In terms of support for disabled people, clearly disabled people, like many other people in our society, have been impacted by COVID over the last year or two, and we are still trying to analyse exactly the scale of that impact. But as I said to the member, this is a really important issue. Disabled people have got a lot to contribute to our economy and should be given the opportunity to work. And as we refresh our action plan, we will take into account all our experience of this issue and lessons learnt in the last couple of years, particularly given the impact of COVID.
A supplementary, Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's vital that we press ahead with work to remove and reduce barriers that prevent disabled people from benefiting from our economic recovery. So can the Minister therefore provide an update regarding the Scottish Government's latest assessment of the disability pay gap? And can he provide any further information as to what further action can be taken by the Scottish Government to help reduce this gap?
Minister.
In terms of the pay gap, on average, rates of pay are lower for disabled people than non-disabled people across the whole of the UK. And in 2019, the median hour pay for disabled people in Scotland was 16.5% lower than for non-disabled people. As I said, we are refreshing our Fairer Scotland for Disabled People Employment Action Plan to be published in 2022. And later this year, we will also consult on proposals to expand the existing duties on public authorities to publish information on their gender pay gap, to include reporting on disability and ethnicity pay gaps as well, through a review of the operation of the public sector equality duty in Scotland. So we are taking a number of measures to tackle the barriers that many people in our society, particularly disabled people, do face.
Question number six, Maggie Chapman, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on progress with the support available for cooperatives for the transition to a new economy.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
Cooperative business models can play a critical role in economic recovery, supporting the Scottish Government's aim to be a fairer, stronger, more democratic country and economy. And we will continue to work through Cooperative Development Scotland and the enterprise agencies to support growth of cooperative and other alternative business models. We will set out how we will provide tailored support for businesses with alternative ownership models, including cooperatives and social enterprises, with a view to increasing the representation in the Scottish economy. And this includes considering how support for such models can be brought into mainstream activity to ensure more values-led outcomes.
Maggie Chapman.
Can I thank the Minister for that response? Across many sectors, from agriculture to energy, there is a recognition that inclusive and efficient cooperatives and producer organisations can play a key role in supporting small businesses and marginalised groups, including women and young people. They empower their members economically and socially and create sustainable employment through business models that are resilient to economic and environmental shocks. There are significant opportunities here, especially perhaps in rural and peri-urban areas, for such models in short food supply chains, housing, energy production, tourism and others. Can I ask the Minister, can he provide a little bit more detail specifically on the funding and financing options, including tax reliefs for cooperatives across different sectors, and also what timescale we might be looking at for these?
Minister.
Thank you. As Maggie Chapman just outlined, this is actually an issue I think is very aligned with the Scottish Government's Fair Work agenda. But it's important to say that since its inception, Cooperative Development Scotland services have been delivered by Scottish Enterprise, support business growth across Scotland and assisting in the creation of more co-ops and employee-owned businesses. But that work includes the promotion of the cooperative model, the direct provision of business advice, particularly to start-up co-ops, and the provision of training in cooperative business skills as well. In terms of the financial incentives and tax incentives, clearly, we have very limited opportunities for that in Scotland, but if the member wishes to write to me, I'll certainly speak to finance colleagues and explore what is in place just now, what more might be possible.
Question number seven, Willie Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how the enterprise agencies support economic growth in Ayrshire.
To respond, Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes.
Will our Economic Recovery Implementation Plan committed Scottish Enterprise to work intensively with partners in Ayrshire to support economic recovery across the region? And last year, Scottish Enterprise spent just over £16 million in Ayrshire, taking into account COVID support grants. They're also contributing to projects being delivered under the Ayrshire Growth Deal and working with local authorities and Business Gateway to produce regional business support plans and to support regional company growth pilots. The agency continues to offer expertise and investment in strategic sites such as the Halo Enterprise and the Innovation Centre in Kilmarnock. Presiding Officer, I could go on, but in the interest of time, I'll draw my comments to a close there.
Willie Coffey.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? As she knows, Ayrshire still trails behind the rest of Scotland when it comes to employment and unemployment figures, and is one of three areas identified by the Scottish Government requiring the most support for economic recovery. Could the Cabinet Secretary outline what progress has been made towards identifying and supporting the important regional company growth pilots?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's a hugely important question, and just for context, it's worth noting that over the last decade alone, Scottish Enterprise has supported 37 inward investment projects in Ayrshire, creating 2,330 jobs. And a joint operational team involving the three Ayrshire councils and Scottish Enterprise has been established to develop an integrated and consistent company support landscape. Now, they have a number of priority areas that would include community wealth building to promote local procurement, fair work and climate action, support to local businesses to implement digital transformation projects, which I know is an interest close to Willie Coffey's heart, and targeted grant funding through the Ayrshire Food and Drink Productivity Fund to support Ayrshire companies deliver productivity improvements that result in automation and reduce carbon emissions. Understandably, all key players involved in the development of the growth pilots and regional business support plans have, over the last year, focused their efforts on delivering COVID support. But we now know that businesses and organisations are increasingly focused on economic recovery.
Question number 8, Jamie Halker-Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government what recent changes it has made to its public procurement policies, including as a result of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee report on its inquiry into construction and procurement of ferry vessels in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes.
Well, any changes to procurement policy over the last year have focused largely around COVID and driving more socio-economic outcomes and best practice. Any changes to Scottish procurement policy notes and construction policy notes are published on our website. Those policy changes bear no correlation to the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee report on its inquiry into construction and procurement of ferry vessels in Scotland. So there have been no recent changes to procurement legislation.
Jamie Halker-Johnson.
I would normally thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but I'm slightly disappointed to hear that. The Cabinet Secretary will know well that these issues just aren't about the waste of millions of pounds of public money. They're examples of communities losing out on vital lifeline services. The problems at Ferguson Marine are ongoing, but we know too that Scotland has an ageing ferry fleet, one which will need not only maintenance, but also serious investment in replacement vessels in the coming years. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that lessons will be learned and that the failures we have seen, most notably in relation to the ferries still lying unfinished at Ferguson Marine, cannot and will not happen again?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I do understand the sentiment behind Jamie Halker-Johnson's question. And CMAL, which is, of course, the procuring authority for new vessels, operates under the Utilities Contracts Scotland Regulations 2016, which serves the same purpose as Public Contracts Scotland Regulations 2015. And they also comply with the statutory and legislative requirements derived from the Procurement Reform Scotland Act 2014. But in a direct answer to Jamie Halker-Johnson's question, CMAL do continue to employ more robust processes following lessons learned in previous projects and output from the REC committee, including employing a ship broker early in the process to provide greater understanding of the market, enhancing the level of evidence required from bidders around finance, refunds and technical abilities, and undertaking site visits at ITT stage. So I hope that gives the member some reassurance that lessons have been learned and are being learned.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions, and there'll be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.